family-owned business in Wisconsin. They took time to huddle up and figured out a very redneck save for us. They said, you know, Pam has essentially the same properties as some of our coatings, so why don't you try spraying those with Pam and let it soak in, and then therefore the cardboard will have soaked in all the oils that it can, and it won't soak up anymore. Lo and behold, we buy Pam, and it works. It's a little extra trouble, and once we get through these 5,000 pieces, you know, I know where to buy the next ones that'll work. But so that was one of those little things that as you're developing a new business, you just have to adjust and adapt. And so I don't have Pam on the list of ingredients, but they do use Pam. What else do we need to talk about, Olivia, that would be interesting?
We can talk about, we have all of our social media accounts on here.
Our website. Lesson that we definitely learned from building and are still learning and building Big City Market is that social media is just the bomb, but you got to watch it all the time, be cautious with it, work it. With MadCity, Big City Market now, I think we have close to 3,500 followers. MadCity, we're probably in the 1,500 to 1,800 range right now. But what that means is on between the two businesses and on social media, we really need to work hard at it. We can reach about 10,000 people in a single day, which is good to get our message out. And we work primarily Facebook and Instagram. Olivia handles Instagram because I'm just too old to get Instagram. I was proud of myself that I can pretty much manage the Facebook account. We don't really do Twitter because we don't have that quick, immediate, you know, we got five left, you know, kind of thing. We really don't need to do that. And then we worked hard on our website, which I still believe, even though Facebook and social media is king, you still need to have a website and a place for people to slow down and really look at all your products. And so we had that professionally designed by a gentleman named Jerry Papineau. He's done a great job. He's also a photographer and local guide, and again, did it for a fraction of the cost that we were getting quoted out of the market. Which I think their quote was $7,500. We technically challenged this morning
the computer.
Our Wi-Fi, yeah. We have one piece of our website is left to develop, and that is our catalog page. We started out thinking where we would do online ordering. But with having a handmade product, we decided that's really not practical. So we are creating a catalog page that basically takes our price list and breaks it down and shows examples of each potential customization of the cookie. And then basically request that the customer contact us for more information. We have our phone is actually a cell phone, so we can text, which today, you know, nobody wants to talk to you anymore than want to text you, so we figured business probably wouldn't be any different. And that's worked really well. And then, of course, we, you know, email and whatever all off that website. Is it not working?
It's not. I'm going to step back in front. I've got an alternative.
Okay, good. That's the advantage of being farther. We have consciously made a decision not to go gangbusters with marketing or direct marketing our cookies. We do have a prospect list that we're going to start working in January with Gusto. We're expanding Big City. We already have a large order for local company Tungo. We're going to be creating 180 of these cookies, the hand ice logo, with a little holiday, you know, type feel to it, but in Tungo's colors. And we're actually doing fulfillment for them. We're going to be shipping our cookies all over the world. We have crush-proof boxes, and we're also sourcing some additional gift items to go in the boxes. Like, basically what they've done, they provided their marketing material, their Christmas card, their vendor list, their customer list, and they said, you handle it, so we're going to handle that. And so that's going to be a big, big, big order that we have to get out first week of December. And these are just some examples of some things that we've done, fun stuff. Before we take our tour, what questions do you have for us?
You talked about doing larger orders for groups along those lines. Like, how do you, what are sort of some of the smaller types of things that you do? Like, would you do not a custom shake, but like custom icing for a company with like 6 employees that wanted to get them something?
We generally request a minimum of a dozen for custom cookies. And the reason for that is because the only economy of scale we can get is in mixing our icing. And so mixing icing for 2, 3, 6 cookies is not really cost effective for us, because I think mixing the icing, getting the right consistency, the right color, is one of the most time consuming parts of the whole process. But absolutely, we can do smaller orders. We have going out tomorrow, we have a gift basket that's going to the Women's Club auction of custom cookies. You know, we're doing a dozen of those. And then we try to keep our kind of our standard cookies in production and then sell in Big City, which generally, as soon as we produce them, they're gone. We've had a couple requests to wholesale, and I'm still vacillating on that. We have a small facility, and we have a couple other women that come in and help us ice when we need, when we're crunch time and you need some help. I'm still not sure that wholesale with our size facility is a good move for us. I think we can probably, once we get to really marketing the company and I get out on the road in the spring, that we can fill our capacity at retail, which is obviously a much higher profit margin for us. Our standard cookie retails for $7, and it's packaging, of course, you know. And I'm not sure, we would have an okay profit margin to wholesale it for $50, maybe. I'm just not sure that we want to do that, and that's something that I really want to, we continually were batting that about, as to, and really, if we decide to do that, I think we can do it in a big way, but that's going to require some extra people and a little bit more continual operation, like at night and that type of thing. So we're still working through that.
Jennie, what's your production capacity? Given your size, obviously the flexibility to people up, but what would be your production capacity?
Well, I think we can, we can easily produce 100 cookies a day. Now, maybe not necessarily Tungo's, because that's basically a 4-stage process. But, our single color or two color cookies, we should be able to do 100.
It really bothers me that you don't seem very scared of things. You don't really seem to get scared about business. I mean, you seem not bothered by fear.
Having 5,000 pieces of useless cardboard?
Exactly. Is that true? Is that true? I mean, do you kind of get daunted? It doesn't seem like it.
Oh, sure, but I had the opportunity to work with the masters of the universe in Louisville, at least according to them. For about 15 years, I worked in the commercial construction and development business, and I was a lender, and my clients built hotels and shopping centers and Walgreens all over the country and apartment complexes, and I learned from them that, you know, when they would look at a big project, which would be potentially the loss of millions and millions of dollars, okay, if it didn't work, I watched their thought process, and they did lots and lots of due diligence on the front end. They got their answers, and then they made their decision, and they committed themselves to that project, and they approached it as, I mean, this will be successful. We might have to make changes along the way, but this is a successful project. And I remember one of them told me when we were looking at an open field and we were getting ready to start development of a big multi-use development out on East Louisville before Louisville jumped the Gene Snyder, if you're familiar with Louisville. And I was just, to me, it was just so overwhelming. I was early in my career. And he said, Jennie, it's just a matter of moving dirt. You know, it's just moving dirt. And that's what this is. You know, once you have your answers and you know you've done your homework, and we have, and then we still have to adjust, Pam, okay? But once you've really done your homework and you're assured that this is a product that can work, or this is a business that can work, then you just have to approach it like it is going to be successful. I mean, you can't waste a lot of your energy worrying that it's not going to be successful, because that's self-defeating, and it's just going to suck that extra that you need to push forward and work 12, 14, 16 hours a day, you know. So, sure, I watch the numbers and I think, oh, I wish, you know, we need to do this or that, and we make adjustments, but I wouldn't say I'm afraid of it.
Yeah.
Yes?
I just want to thank you for doing cookies for my son's leg. Very impressive. Mm-hmm. I think that was your first big order.
Mm-hmm. It was.
Thank you. 80 cookies that my new daughter-in-law tied to in L.A. and lined them all up for gifts, for party gifts at the reception. And everybody was very impressed. They were packaged well. They were in hard boxes that I took to Lexington. Not a broken cookie. So, very nice. Very nice. Everybody was very impressed.
Weddings is another great example of what we can do to provide a unique wedding favor. We can do them in, you know, custom colors, and I can't say it's going to exactly match the bridesmaids' dresses that this big color came from, but it's going to be pretty darn close. So, and they were very well received. And that, you know, that's a picture of at the wedding. It was a really great presentation, and everybody went crazy about it. Yes.
All right. Well, you make it look easy, but you come from a family that's very entrepreneurial. We've all seen your parents, you know, do what they do, and you have it in your blood. You started. You know, everyone is so happy you run here about MadCity.
It took me to make coffee.
Yeah. Because you know that's why I moved here. Because I needed coffee, and y'all didn't have it before MadCity. So yeah. So after that, so this is, you know, this is basically your, I guess, second endeavor, third if you count food and lunch and everything, whatever, this is a biggie. What did you take from MadCity, maybe things that you wish you would have done differently in the beginning that you changed this time? Or how did, you know, successes and failures, how did they add into what you're doing now and make this even better?
Well, I think the biggest thing that I learned from MadCity that I try to correct here is do it right the first time. Don't, you know, when we started MadCity, I had this piece of junk used machine, espresso machine, and I didn't think it was junk, you know, but it doesn't do anything what Luigi can do. I should have just bought Luigi to start with, and, you know, gone on about it. Tried to use a residential little beverage fridge, you know, for milk, you know, that lasted about 2 weeks, and I was, you know, I was out buying a new under cabinet fridge. I made, even after that experience, I made some of those same mistakes when we started our food piece of it. And a friend of mine once told me, you go broke buying for sale, and it's true. It really is true. Just bite the bullet, do it, you know, spend the money you need to. Now, you can save money other ways and put in sweat equity, but as far as equipment, just go ahead and do it. So, I spent a good amount of time with Aaron, and we put together equipment that we felt we could grow into. It wasn't excessive, but we really paid attention to sizing all the equipment so one wouldn't outperform the other. There was no sense in having an oven that could bake 200 cookies at one time if my mixer couldn't produce that many at one, you know what I mean? So, we bought, I'm not aware of any used equipment that we can have that we rely on every day and some little stuff. But that's the biggest thing that I learned is to, because I'm the type of person that I want to do it myself. I'm not going to pay anybody to paint. I can paint just fine, you know. But some things you just got to go ahead and pay people and just do it. And our logo was another thing. You know, we spent a lot of time trying to develop a logo, and it was cute and all, but it wasn't where we needed to be. So we just paid money and had some professionals, you know, do our design for us and do our artwork, you know, for our cookie backer. So that's really the biggest thing that I've had learned. What else? Okay. Yes.
Every business, at least in our experience, yeah, you've got to look at the financing, you've got to look at the marketing plan, you've got to look at the product or the service, but ultimately it comes down to the team that you put together. Mm-hmm. One of the things, being in here a fair amount, that I've just been impressed with from day one is your team. And yeah, you've got to have the leadership and the vision at the top, but I know in our business, we live and die by our team, apparently. Talk a little about that and how you've done that and lessons learned, if you will.
When MadCity started, it was just Molly and myself. And we lasted about a month doing it by ourselves. And unfortunately, MadCity was more successful than I really thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be this quiet little coffee shop, and I'd hang out, and I'd paint furniture. that didn't work out that way, thankfully. I have never at this point put an ad out for help wanted. We all, when we need, it's terrifying to me to hire the next person, because the next person can ruin everything that you've worked on in building your team. And so before we hire somebody, those of us that are already here, we sit down and talk about it. We talk about what we need, the type of person we think we need, And then we searched our brains and talked to people. Olivia came up with our morning prep, who's just somebody who's, you know, who's a brother or somebody she knew, and, you know, and but I think it's wise, especially in a shop our size, to empower your existing team to participate in the decision of hiring the next team member, because that gives them a vested interest. If everybody has to say this or this, then everyone's committed to making that work because they were part of that decision. And our last barista that we hired, who I hope after the first of the year, we needed this space because we had run out of space at lunch, but our intention is after the first of the year to get a beer and wine license. We'll only do premium beer and wine, and we'll have it'll be a little cocktail party that we want every night. We'll do a happy hour kind of deal. But our new barista, we're training him and bringing him on to be able to take over that beverage, that nighttime beverage operation. But pretty much all of us met with him as a group and individually, because not, you know, I may miss something that somebody else picked up, and then we huddled up and talked about it before we made him an offer of employment. But I really have been fortunate, and, you know, Olivia I knew since she was 3 years old. I try not to treat her like a 3-year-old now. I have my mom and stuff. I just want to spank her. But I've intentionally, even though on that side we're now in the restaurant business. I always said I'd never be in the restaurant business, but I am. I'm in the restaurant business. I intentionally tried to attract people that were not from the local restaurant business, because we have a pretty small community, and they learn from each other, and they learn some bad habits, and we have our own way. We don't have what Bartholomew's way was, or, you know, number. I'm not saying that they're, you know, that this is our way, and so I've intentionally gone after people that are not from that scene, so they can learn the big city way.
Well, as you go to various restaurants, I know what I know, but something for the staff that I saw at one place is not another place.
They move all the time.
And what they do is somebody opens a new place and say, here, let's put up our ad. And all they did was get the ones that everybody was moving around, so you've got all the ones that everybody else was fired. That's where you start.
Yeah, exactly. And now, for the most part, I know this because I know this was a big problem at Bartholomew's with my parents, and it was a 250-seat restaurant. They had 35 employees. And they would move for 15 cents an hour, and it was just every day was tenuous. I mean, you didn't know what your staff was going to be there, if they were all going to be there, if you had to go get somebody out of jail. I mean, you know, and that was reality. That really, in a restaurant that size, that is definitely reality. And so we don't have any wait staff. We're all counter service. We'll continue to be counter service. We pay our employees. We start out well above minimum wage, and we increase based on performance. And I try to provide as many benefits as I can. We outsource, if you will, our HR to Permco, which is kind of part of People Plus, and that's probably the best single decision I've made. Let's say we would be out of business if I had tried to do all the withholdings and submit the reports and the taxes because we've gone from 2 of us to 9 of us. Isn't it 9? Or 10? Is it 10? Because I know we outstripped our free time station number.
Yeah.
And, you know, some of them work very frequently just on special projects, but you still have to do all the, you know, sure they're not a terrorist and, you know, I mean, you know, all that stuff. Whether they're going to work 5 hours a week or 40 hours a week. And you still have to do the withholdings and inform them of all this stuff they have to get informed of. We have drug policy, we have formal drug policy now. Everyone gets drug tested, period. That's a condition of employment, and staying drug free is a condition of continued employment. And phone call handles all that. So just come in, do the paperwork, do the drug test. I say thank you. Thank you. Okay. All right. Let's take a quick tour. We've got a lot of people. Oh yeah. See our video. All right. This will show you real quickly how we create set practice.
Okay.
Okay. Yes. Flour and the sugar, which these are both full of both of each, because we go through a lot of flour and sugar, obviously. This is our industrial mixer. It was the most intimidating thing I've ever put together in my life. But for this, we can mix up dough to do about 6 dozen cookies, which again is a lot of dough. This is where we keep all of our baking supplies, and this is where we decorate. These chairs raise up and down, the back turns up and down, because when you're icing a lot of cookies,
you want to find a really good ergonomic position to be in. Otherwise, you go through a lot of ibuprofen.
These are all of our cutters. For the most part, we hand make all of our cutters. We start with plumbing strap, and then when it absolutely wears out, we switch to this nice brass. We found it just easier to make our own cutters because then they look like we want. We tried with this one right here. I found on Etsy these people that make 3D cookie cutters with a 3D printer. You just send them a picture, and I was like, that's going to save us so much time. And if I squeeze them a little harder, it would break. A for effort, but it won't work.
Who makes your cutters?
We make the ones with plumbing strap, and then Jennie's husband Lee solders the more permanent ones for us after we go through. Like, this one's Michigan. We don't do a whole lot of Michigan, so the plumbing straps lasted for a while. But
she's like Utah and North Dakota, South Dakota.
Square state.
Just square.
Colorado. What's interesting is they don't fit in our packaging. So right now we offer 43 of the 50 states because the big square packaging. Or big square ones won't fit in our packaging, and the idea of trying to find more cardboard makes me nauseous. So we're not going to do that right now. If you'll trade me places. So this is what you call a proofer. When you ice cookies, you put them all in here. You can turn the fan on, or you can turn heat on, which it's going to work like a warmer in that case. So we used to have to let our cookies sit for 24 hours overnight to let them surface dry before we put logos on or did anything in addition to. And now we throw them in here and turn the heat on in the fan, and it takes about an hour and a half to flash dry them, which is awesome. It really cut down on this time. This is our giant refrigerator, and we have, and that wine's from the other night, I promise. We have a prep cook that makes all of our dough for us, and she sheets it all at night and rolls it out. We're kind of spoiled. All we do is come in and cut the cookies. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sheets of dough right now, all double stacked. So this would get me about 8 dozen cookies. And we do that about 3 times a week. And I'll bake them all off, actually, when you guys leave. So if you'll come through here. Oh, icing station. This is where we mix all of our icing. We can make any color in the room. And this is our packaging room. This is our little assembly line on the other side here. Jennie and I make our own little factory. She starts stuffing. This is our thermosealer. So we seal the cookies good for this. So we wait till they dry, we slide a cookie in, we thermoseal it, we put a sticker on it, we put it in press-proof box, so it's where she thinks all over the country. These really are press-proof, we stood on them to make sure. And then this little thing over here, last but not least.
Sorry, honey.
This is actually a projector. Remember all the Jack cookies we made? So you put Jack's face up here, or any other design you want to do for that matter. Throw your cookie underneath here, and then you can just use the icing to trace it in. Don't tell anybody else.
It sounds really easy.
It sounds really easy.
But it's not.
It's not. If anybody didn't get a cookie, please grab one on your way out.
Where's the printer where you do the...
We use this little can printer right here.
Mm-hmm. And it's, you have, what's the...
So it's wafer paper.
I remember when y'all got it, but I never did.
It's just a coloring cartridge.
Six months later, we figured out how to use it. Yeah. So this is wafer paper.
Yummy.
I have to.
It's like communion.
It really is. It just dissolves in your mouth. It has literally no taste. And then the ink that we use is a sugar-based ink, obviously. So when we lay these over the top of the icing, the wafer paper somewhat dissolves on top of the icing, and then you can eat it.
Sweet.
So it is edible ink, though. But it's a typical residential printer that we use with edible ink. It's a pain, but it works. So, like I said, you guys pick up a cookie if you didn't get one. If you have any questions, please let me know.
They made these for us to take to Kansas City for the 1MillionCups conference, and we only got a dozen, and oh my gosh, people were fighting for them. We just thought we'd give them to special people, and everyone was like, but I want one of those, you know, so we should have had more. We should have had way more, yeah.
Next time I'll make you more.
Yeah.
Very good. And where do you keep the bourbon?
We hide it. It's open.
I saw it on the shelf over there, Sally.
What we do is we set out the Heaven Hill bourbon and then we hide the Makers in the
cookie. I was going to say, surely you don't put Makers in a cookie.
If anybody asks,
you can't tell the difference once you put all the sugar and sugar in.
That's right.
So you don't waste good bourbon in cookies.
That was my point.
Exactly. Okay, yeah, you guys make sure and grab this.
Great.
This is awesome.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Little frog.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I could never. I can't break
the eye. I know. I'm
just blessed.
I can't hear. I'm so shy.
We got you.